Six Flags Magic Mountain is my home park. It's always been my home park, and it's hard to imagine life where it wouldn't be my home park. I started coming here to actually ride the coasters back in 2000, so 2020 marks 20 years for me with this park. I've ridden all of the coasters here so many times, including most of the coasters that are long gone. You'll find a lot of lists out there that rank the coasters at Magic Mountain, but I'm going to take that a step further. Today, I'm going to rank all of the coasters that ever operated at Six Flags Magic Mountain. Number 27, Green Lantern First Flight, Intamin Zaxpan. Opened in 2011, closed in 2017, removed in 2019. This ranks behind the kiddie coasters because it ranks behind all coasters. This was the worst coaster ever. Thanks to California regulations, the weight of the cars were not as designed, and the ride never really flipped as it was supposed to, causing a painful and uncomfortable ride that made me think that it may have been dangerous to my brain if I rode this too many times. I'm not the only one who hated this coaster, and this train wreck of a coaster was packed up and shipped off to La Ronde in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. I rode this maybe 5 or 6 times over the years, from its opening year to its closing year, and I swore it off forever after my last ride in 2017. I didn't know it would close a couple months later, but I was not too upset when it did. Number 26, Magic Flyer, Bradley & Kay Little Dipper. This kiddie coaster originated at Beverly Park in Los Angeles way back in 1947, but closed after the 1970 season and was moved to Magic Mountain for its inaugural 1971 season as Clown Coaster. It was then rebranded as Wile E. Coyote Coaster back in 1985, and then was put into storage after the 1998 season. It re-emerged as Goliath Jr. in 2001 in its current location, and then was renamed Percy's Railway when its area became themed to Thomastown in 2008. And when the Thomastown area became the generic Whistle Stop Park in 2011, it received its current name, Magic Flyer. I guess it was possible that I rode this in my younger years when it was the Wile E. Coyote Coaster, since I went to the park a few times in the early 90s, but there's no way to know for sure if I have this credit. Since there is a height limit on this, I will never be able to get this credit, so I'll have to rely on Sophie's review.
It was okay, I guess.
So it seems like number 26 is a good spot for it. Number 25, Speedy Gonzales Hot Rod Racers, Zamperla Family Gravity Coaster, opened in 2014. This is the newest of Magic Mountain's 4 kiddie coasters, and it's pretty basic. There are over 40 of these worldwide, including Dollywood, Holiday World, Discovery Kingdom, and Great Adventure, just to name a few. Swooping Drop, Helix, Turn Into the Station. Very mild, but kind of a good transition coaster between Magic Flyer and the next coaster on my list, which is a little more aggressive. Number 24, Canyon Blaster, E&F Miler Family Coaster, opened in 1999. You really can't go wrong with an E&F Miler. Even though this is another basic kiddie coaster, it features a nice big camelback before the Helix, and then some really aggressive bunny hops at the end. This is why Speedy Gonzales is a nice transition coaster. Canyon Blaster may be too much for some of the kids trying to break into the coaster world. This same model can be found at Storybook Land in New Jersey and Carowinds, so if you're familiar with those parks, you know what I'm talking about. Number 23, Roadrunner Express, Vekoma Junior Coaster. Originally opened in 2000 along with its park, Jazzland in New Orleans. Its original name was Rex's Rail Runner. It was then renamed to Roadrunner Express when Six Flags bought Jazzland and turned it into Six Flags New Orleans for the 2003 season. After Hurricane Katrina damaged the park beyond repair in August of 2005, Roadrunner Express would stand dormant until 2009 when it was finally dismantled and moved to its new home at Magic Mountain for the 2011 season, taking over the former place of the tube slide, Sierra Falls. This is a true family coaster, really the only one the park has, and is really the last stepping stone that kids can conquer before moving on to the big rides. These Vekoma family coasters are pretty common with almost 30 worldwide, including Disneyland, Universal Orlando, Kentucky Kingdom, and Six Flags Great America. Number 22, Flashback, Intamin Space Diver. Originally was named Z-Force and was part of the Six Flags Ride Rotation program back in the 1980s, starting at Six Flags Great America in 1985 and then Six Flags Over Georgia in 1988 before finding its forever home at Magic Mountain in 1992. Yeah, we got stuck with this thing playing musical chairs with the Six Flags parks. It happened to land with us when Six Flags decided to discontinue their ride rotation program. This was one of the strangest coasters I had ever ridden. It had over-the-shoulder restraints, and every time the train would enter one of those hairpin dives, your head would be destroyed. This thing looked like it was designed to fit in a confined rectangular space first and foremost, and the fun factor was secondary. Intamin hasn't really blessed Magic Mountain with much over the years, and this was pretty dreadful. This was also incredibly loud, and its location right next to Hurricane Harbor did not help. So it would be closed during the summer months and operate only in the off-season. I rode this several times between 2001 and 2003 before it went into standing but not operating mode and was finally demolished in 2007. I took a cool picture of it being taken apart when I was working at the park back then, but that cell phone is long gone, along with the picture. Oh well. Number 21. Cyclone. Din Corporation Wooden Cyclone. Opened in 1991, closed in 2006. I actually have some fond, vivid memories of riding this coaster from 2000 through 2003. It rarely had a line, I like wooden coasters, and it's just a shame that this one was such a dumpster fire. I remember getting chili cheese fries from the Surfside Grill that was right next to the ride, and then riding it and then being in so much pain from head to toe. I was in junior high and I was stupid, what can I say? Between the fact that this was a Din coaster and the fact that it had those heavy fiberglass B&M trains, this was a match made in hell. And after just 15 years, Magic Mountain decided to get rid of this thing for something much more modern. The GCI Terminator Salvation the Ride, now known as Apocalypse. Number 20. Gold Rusher. Aerodynamics Mine Train. Opened as the park's flagship attraction in 1971. Every park needs an aero mine train that dates back to the beginning. And Magic Mountain has a good one that will turn 50 next year. This was built on the side of a mountain. It goes up and over it twice, and it has a tremendous helix finale. It's funny looking at old pictures of the coaster back in the 70s where there were no trees and how much the landscape has changed over the years. It's actually really hard to get footage of Gold Rusher these days since so much of the ride is hidden behind the trees that have grown in over the decades. This is the only coaster that has continuously operated at the park since the start and hopefully it sticks around. Number 19. Shockwave. Intamin Stand-Up Coaster. Opened in 1986, closed in 1988. I admit that I did not ride this. But I have an excuse. By the time it was taken out, I wasn't even 1 year old. Yes, another one of those rides that was part of Six Flags ride rotation program. It found its way over to Great Adventure for the 1990 season before finding its permanent home at Six Flags Astro World in 1993. It would operate there for 12 years before the park closed in 2005. It was dismantled and moved to Darien Lake, where it was never constructed. Since I never got to ride Shockwave, I can only compare it to similar coasters I've ridden. I'm drawing the closest comparison to Vortex at Carowinds, a small-scale B&M stand-up coaster. Even though Shockwave was an Intamin coaster, two of the designers were Giovanola employees, Walter Bolliger and Claude Mabillard, who would split off and form B&M in 1987. It makes sense that all of the small stand-up coasters from that era would give similar ride experiences, and I was not a big fan of Vortex. I think it's B&M's worst coaster that I've ridden, but I'll give them a pass because they were just starting out, and they quickly improved with Batman the Ride and Kumba. There weren't many Intamin stand-up coasters out there. This was just one of three. The other two include Cobra at La Ronde, which was shut down after the 2016 season, and Shockwave at Drayton Manor, which is the only one still operating today. Number 18. Revolution, a Schwarzkopf Looper. Opened in 1976 as the first modern coaster to feature a vertical loop. Aerodynamics and Schwarzkopf were busy in the mid to late 70s, filling parks with inverting coasters. But Revolution barely checked in ahead of Cedar Point's Corkscrew as having the first vertical loop, beating it by 1 week. This isn't to be confused with the first modern inverting coaster, which was Knott's Corkscrew in 1975, which is now operating at Silverwood. Revolution has a great layout along the mountainside and it's a long ride with lots of good elements, including big drops, a tunnel, and a helix, along with that iconic loop. Over the years, the trees have grown in around the track, which has given it a great setting. My one complaint about the ride is that despite a good layout with good elements, it's pretty forceless. Its best function these days is to introduce kids to their first inversion. This was Sophie's first looping coaster and she loves it. It's a perfect coaster to flip you upside down without being super scary or intense. And it's a living coaster legend, so it will be around for the long haul. Number 17. Scream, a B&M Floorless. Opened in 2003. The early 2000s were marked by the B&M Floorless coaster, and Scream was kind of late to the party. This is a mirror image of the original Floorless, the coaster now known as Bizarro at Six Flags Great Adventure. Magic Mountain would just hack off part of their parking lot and stick this onto the flat surface. On paper, this ride looks great. 7 inversions over almost 4,000 feet of track. But even if you can put aside the bland parking lot setting, another, more major issue will hinder your ride. Scream has a pretty nasty rattle that has given me headaches in the past. The Elements also don't really pop for me either, with the exception of the zero-G roll. I think it has a pretty weak layout, and I rarely ride it when I go to the park. Contrast this with Medusa at Six Flags Discovery Kingdom, which has really good elements even though that's basically a parking lot coaster also. Scream, to me, is a pretty big dud and would be much better suited at a park like Six Flags Over Texas or Six Flags St. Louis, where it would be one of their better coasters. Number 16. Ninja, an aero suspended coaster, opened in 1988. This was another great terrain coaster built early in Magic Mountain's history, starting from the top of Samurai Summit and going up a small lift before winding all the way down to the bottom of the hill, the climax being a low swooping turn over Jetstream's Lake. The one downside of this is that the ride ends with a totally anticlimactic chain lift back to the station. If this was more like Thunderation at Silver Dollar City, where it needs to climb back up to the top of the hill but has a thrilling section of the ride after that, it would be so much better. This is a borderline family coaster and its 42-inch height limit makes it a big hit with the kids. This is a middle-of-the-road suspended coaster also. More extreme than Cedar Point's Iron Dragon, but not quite as wild as the Bat at Kings Island or Vortex at Canada's Wonderland. It's a solid ride that's a good fit for the park. Number 15. Goliath, a Geo Vanilla Hyper, opened in 2000. This was the first coaster of the Millennium to open, and it enjoyed the title of World's Tallest Drop for a few months before Millennium Force opened. Geo Vanilla served as a subcontractor for a bunch of Intamin coasters in the 80s, but only built three coasters themselves, including Goliath. This was built to be a hyper twister coaster, and I used to think this was the greatest coaster in the world when it was brand new, mainly because I was afraid of it, and I felt a sense of accomplishment after riding it. But it has a drop that's incredibly shallow, a lame turnaround, an airtime hill with mild floater, a harsh mid-course brake run, and then a bunch of turns to finish the ride off, including an intense helix. Sometimes I get the urge to ride this, but I always walk away remembering why I don't like this ride. The fun factor for me is next to zero, even though it's nice and smooth. There's just so many coasters in the park that do so much more, and Goliath is a perfect example of how you can waste height and speed into a terrible layout. Number 14. Mountain Express, a Schwarzkopf Wildcat. Opened in 1973, closed in 1982, and then served a couple stints at a park in El Paso, Texas, and then Mexico before being disassembled in 2006. This was removed 5 years before I was born, so I never got to ride this. But based on the other Schwarzkopf Wildcats I've ridden, I can make a judgment. This is the same exact model that you'll find at the Washington State Fair, and over the last several months, I've made a few videos talking about how much I enjoyed that coaster. Who knows if this one ran as well as the Wildcat in Washington currently runs, but if it did, then this would have been a great coaster to keep around as an intermediate family-style coaster. It used to sit on the old Flashback plot of land, and now that Flashback is gone, the park should totally bring it back. Number 13. Superman the Escape, an Intamin Reverse Freefall, opened in 1997. This is the best Intamin to ever operate at Magic Mountain, which isn't saying much. This was a prototype and the first coaster to reach the 100 mile per hour mark, and it naturally had a lot of problems, which pushed a 1996 opening to 1997. It doesn't have the fastest launch, taking 7 seconds to hit that 100 mile per hour mark. The speed is really the main attraction here, as you keep gaining it until going up the 415-foot spike. How far you go up really varies. Usually it's maybe 2/3 of the way up. Until 2010, you would launch forward and enjoy the weightlessness when you would start to do the reverse freefall. In 2011, the tower was painted from gray to blue, red, and yellow, and they turned the cars around so it would launch backwards. They also added bulky shoulder restraints. I used to think that this was a lot more fun than I do now. I've walked away disappointed more often than not the last couple years, so it's starting to slip in my rankings. Superman is a historical coaster for cracking the 100 mile per hour mark, but it's not much of a ride anymore. Number 12. Batman the Ride, a B&M Invert, opened in 1994. This Batman clone was one of the early ones, opening just 2 years after the original at Six Flags Great America. There are a lot of intense rides at Magic Mountain, and this one is near the top of the list. It's small, compact, and has very whippy elements, and is really non-stop intensity through its 5 inversions. I personally prefer the larger B&M Inverts with the custom layouts like Montu, Banshee, and Raptor, but there's nothing wrong with Batman the Ride. It's just small and not original, so I don't have it ranked as high on this list. Number 11. Riddler's Revenge, B&M Stand-Up, opened in 1998. While Batman was a small clone, Riddler was a huge original. The stand-up coaster was a fad in the 90s and did not stand the test of time. And even the biggest fans of Riddler would probably concede that it would be better with sit-down or flawless trains. It's unlikely that this will ever happen, so we can just keep enjoying Riddler for what it is. Six inversions, over 4,300 feet of track, over 150 feet tall, this thing is just a legitimate monster. The stand-up element is uncomfortable, so it can't break into the top 10, but Riddler's Revenge is really impressive nonetheless. Number 10. Sarajevo Bobsleds, an Intamin bobsled. Opened in 1984, closed after the 1985 season, and was shipped off to Six Flags Over Texas, where it continues to operate today as La Vibora. Before Shockwave occupied this plot of land, Sarajevo Bobsleds was the first to be part of the ride rotation program. This one only saw two locations before it found its permanent home at Six Flags Over Texas, and even though this was removed from Magic Mountain before I was born, I've ridden it as La Vibora plenty of times to have a good feel of it. If you've watched some of my recent videos, you know that I really like La Vibora. It has this out-of-control feeling to it as gravity takes over and you roll through that trough with no attachment to the track whatsoever. It's a really fun, unique ride, and I'm glad it's still around at Over Texas. Number 9. Full Throttle, a premier ride, Skyrocket 3, opened in 2013. After Logjammer's closure in 2011, Full Throttle quickly moved in to replace it, as the park completely gave the front of the park a facelift. I've never been the biggest Full Throttle fan, although it's actually growing on me the more I ride it. I just think that overall, the ride needs more to it for it to be a really great ride. It feels incomplete. This was the perfect coaster for a pros and cons video, which I made last year, since it does so many things well but falls short in so many other ways. I think the launch is weak and the ride is short, but it has great hang time and a great final drop over the top of the loop. It looks great in the front of the park, and it's a fun ride, but it isn't quite up there with the best of the best. Number 8. Colossus, an International Amusement Devices wooden racing coaster. Opened in 1978, closed in 2014 for its transformation into Twisted Colossus. This was a huge deal back in the late 70s, as it opened as the biggest coaster in the world. After Magic Mountain became famous for opening Revolution 2 years earlier, Colossus cemented this park's legacy as a coaster destination. When I first started getting into coasters back in 2000, it didn't get much better than Colossus. I had so much fun on this every time. I said Goliath was my favorite, but it was actually Colossus. I would have loved to ride this with the double camelbacks, but those were removed in 1991. Colossus is still a legend and a great ride, so it deserves to be in the top 10. Number 7. Deja Vu, a Vekoma Giant Inverted Boomerang. Opened in 2001, closed in 2011, relocated to Six Flags New England, and still operates once in a while as Goliath. This was my first big coaster opening. I was first in line on August 25th, 2001, waiting for the gates to open, and ended up on the second public train. I also loved this coaster. It had two huge vertical spikes and inversions that stood over 100 feet tall. It had great intensity and awesome weightless moments of freefall. I was sad to see this go, and even sadder to see how badly it runs at Six Flags New England with its new trains. I got up to Silverwood to ride Aftershock, which was the Deja Vu that operated at Six Flags Great America, and that has the original trains, and I loved it. It gave me flashbacks to how Deja Vu used to be, and I got a big ol' whiff of nostalgia riding Aftershock. Deja Vu is missed. It comes in at number 7. Number 6. Apocalypse, a GCI wooden coaster. Opened in 2009. This originally was called Terminator Salvation the Ride alongside the release of the film. But after two seasons, the Terminator IP was removed, and it was renamed to the generic Apocalypse. This was Magic Mountain's first modern wooden coaster, standing on the old Cyclone plot of land, and it's a favorite among enthusiasts. For me, this is a middle-of-the-road GCI. There are definitely better ones out there, but it's a lot better than a lot of the GCIs I've ridden also. I think the first half of the ride is amazing, but after the station flyby, the ride just dies. I've never thought it was rough, though most people said at some points, it felt like that it had square wheels. Magic Mountain has taken this coaster down for extended periods of time over recent years for retracking, and I think it's paying off nicely. This is one coaster I really enjoy getting on when I can. Number 5. Viper, an Aero Mega Looper. Opened in 1990. It seems like Viper is only getting better with age. Magic Mountain has put a lot of work into keeping this 30-year-old coaster running great, and it's paying off. There's nothing they can do about the bad transitions, but there's no rattle at all, which makes it pain-free for us tall people who don't have to worry about the over-the-shoulder restraints being around our ears. This is nearly 200 feet tall, features 7 inversions, is incredibly intense, has hang time, is a long ride, and that first drop in the back is crazy and you really feel it in your gut. It never has a line, which will probably eventually lead to its demise, but for now, it means that you can get a great ride on this coaster without having to wait, even when the park is crowded. I'm a big Viper fan, a fandom that seems to grow every time I ride it. and I've bumped this all the way into the top 5 for Magic Mountain. Number 4. Tatsu, a B&M flyer, opened in 2006. This was part of the end of the golden years of Six Flags, when they were in big financial trouble but didn't want to admit it yet, and added a whole bunch of great coasters in the middle of the 2000s. Tatsu is absolutely enormous and hard to believe that Six Flags would ever pay for a coaster this expensive. It's situated on top of the mountain and never really makes its way down to the foot of the mountain with one exception, the bottom of that insane pretzel loop. This means that the ride takes place high off the ground for the most part, which adds to the flying sensation. It's mostly a fun, graceful ride until it tries to rip your head off with that pretzel loop. It's kind of hard to take, to be honest, but maybe that's just me getting old. Tatsu is an amazing coaster that adds a lot to Magic Mountain's lineup. Number 3. West Coast Racers, a Premier Rides Mobius Loop dueling launch coaster, opened in 2019, or 2020, depending on who you ask. Call it recency bias, but I just keep pushing this farther and farther up my list. At first, I said that Full Throttle was probably better. Now I'm siding with West Coast Racers. I recently decided that I would rather ride this than Tatsu. It's just a fun, complete coaster with lots of great elements. The high five is especially great. It's a moment of lateral ejector that's hard to find anywhere else. I would compare it to another Premier Rides coaster, the vertical twisting dive on their Skyrocket 2 model. The white track has good moments of floater airtime, and the yellow side delivers the positive G's. I don't think it will ever climb higher than 3, but the more I ride it, the more I'm impressed with everything this ride does, and I'm happy to have this at my home park. Number 2. X2, an Aero 4th Dimension coaster, opened in 2001, or 2002, again, depending who you ask. When I first started getting into coasters in 2000, Six Flags announced that they would be opening 3 coasters for the 2001 season and dubbed themselves the Extreme Park. Deja Vu was cool looking, but X was the real draw, the one-of-a-kind 4th dimension coaster with a drop over 200 feet that would be taken face down. Even though this coaster faced massive delays and opened 6 months late and ended up driving Aero into bankruptcy, it stood the test of time. It did need a makeover in 2008 that was mainly used to get lighter trains that would be easier on the track, and that's when X became X2. Since then, it's been running great and is still one of the more popular rides in the park despite being hard to find. It welcomes guests as they drive toward the parking lot. It's really an intimidating sight. It may be the most intense coaster I've ever ridden, and despite being 18 years old, it still holds a place near my top 10 and will be many people's pick as the best coaster in the park. Number 1. Twisted Colossus, an RMC Mobius Loop dueling hybrid, opened in 2015. Magic Mountain may have a ton of coasters, but they had a serious airtime deficit. When the park announced that their classic wooden coaster, Colossus, would become Twisted Colossus for the 2015 season, we knew this would all change. Not only did Magic Mountain get an RMC, it got one of the best RMCs in the country. It's a long ride with its 2 lift hills, and every element is great. It's the ride that I've ridden the most out of any coaster in the world. Because the park wants it to duel, they try to always run 3 trains, which makes the line move really fast. You're hard-pressed to get a perfect duel, but even without that interaction with the other train, you're still going to get a great airtime and hangtime-filled ride. Magic Mountain, and California as a whole, needed a coaster like Twisted Colossus, and we finally got it, and it's the top ride at Magic Mountain. Magic Mountain has seen 27 coasters in its history, and that's how they rank up, in my opinion. Let me know what you would change about this list in the comments below. And if you like this video, don't forget to hit that thumbs up also. And if you're not subscribed yet, make sure to do that also. And I'll see you guys all next time.